Hi, everybody. We've got about 30 minutes, so I'm going to whip through a presentation really quickly and hope you all remember what I said, because there'll be a test at the end. Just kidding. Welcome. Come sit down. Move close. We're going to try to have some audience participation and interaction. Even though we've got some really esteemed experts who have really interesting things to say, we'd love to have you all participate. This is the image that I was presented with when I submitted the roundtable presentation. It is a forest fire actively burning. I'm not sure who chose it. So today we're going to talk about long-term relationships, how to save the forest when all the trees are on fire. I'm just going to give a couple seconds of introduction to this talk and how we're going to do it, and then we're going to get right into the content. So a UX professional's first contact with a developer or publisher team is often during a time of crisis. The UI is a mess, onboarding is a disaster and ineffective, the game isn't fun, players aren't coming back, time is limited, and resources are tight. What will you do? Do you fix what they think is wrong? Do you go after the low-hanging fruit? Do you throw up your hands in despair? It's easy to get caught up in the fire drill and focus only on the short-term results. And what I encourage UX leaders to do is take a longer-term approach. Recognize that we're all in the industry because we love it and that this one game won't be our last. So I approached four seasoned game industry veterans and talked to them both one-on-one and then in small groups over the past few weeks. And I wanted to gain some of their insights about the firefights they participated in, both the wins and losses, and also about how they built successful long-term relationships with their development partners. And based on these questions, I posed a series of questions to help draw out their experiences, and that's what we're going to go through to start. Over the next 30 minutes, or 26 minutes, we'll discuss at least some of the questions. My intention is to keep this informal. I'll introduce each panelist and ask a question tailored to his or her background and experience. And then I'll moderate a discussion from other panelists and the audience. So we're going to encourage crosstalk amongst the panelists. But also, I want to encourage you all to participate in the conversation to the extent that you have questions or interesting anecdotes. Interesting can be like wild success stories, or they can be embarrassing failures. Sometimes we learn more and are more entertained by some of the failures that I'm sure none of you have ever experienced any failures, but I have, so sometimes we learn from those. My job is just to moderate the discussion. And after the individual questions, I'll provide some more general topics for discussion, and we'll leave time at the end for questions from you all, because I'd like to get you all involved. So the first question to our panelists who volunteered to go first, this is Christian Ress. He's the CEO and co-founder of Playtest Cloud, a leading platform for mobile games user research. He has introduced hundreds of game teams to the benefits of remote user research and co-develops the research software and processes at Playtest Cloud that allow game teams to conduct user research in the growing field of mobile gaming. His main focus is enabling teams to embrace a player experience-driven design process and become champions of UX at their own companies. And Christian holds a master's degree in software engineering and has studied game design at UC Santa Cruz. And the question I posed for Christian, it's a multi-part question, so sorry. Over the past few years, you've likely partnered with more developers than all the four of us other people combined. Part one, and you can answer any of these you want, you don't have to answer all of them. When you're contacted during a firefight, what factors predict research success or failure? When failure occurs, what are your best strategies for re-engaging the team long-term? And what are some of the unusual benefits of having the games teams themselves conduct the user research at this stage?
Yeah, thanks, Jason. So I'm going to start with the last part that you brought up there, because I think what's very different about what we do in our work compared to most of everybody you're going to hear about in a moment is that we don't actually do research for the teams. We make it easier for them to do research. And this poses a few unique challenges, because when teams come to us, it's motivated by something. They have retention problems. They notice that people don't use certain features because maybe they're not understanding it, or maybe they just don't know they exist. And they want to find out why that happens so they can actually launch a successful product. So one of the first and most important things in working with them is that they're actually willing to even address these issues. And this sounds like a no-brainer. You have a problem, you should want to fix it. But the first contact with the games team is often not with the producer or the game designers who are actually working on these problems, but it might be some exec at the company, or it might be somebody completely unrelated who introduces them to you because he heard they have a problem and they think you can help. But now we actually need to convince them that, yeah, like, first of all, the method doing playtesting and watching what people do, learning from that, is a good method to investigate those problems and develop solutions. But secondly, you also need to get the team on board, because the worst thing that can happen is you run a playtest with them, you give them videos of people playing these games, you give them surveys, and they're just like, you know, those people were not the right ones, or they're just looking for all the reasons to discount that feedback and say, no, no, you know, my game's actually good. The players, it's their fault. They're just not getting it. And to get across that hump and actually make them understand that this is data that they need to look at carefully and take into account in their decisions is one of the most important things. And teams who are willing to do that and to have an open mind also going into this are much more likely to also succeed at actually solving these problems.
So you're offering this service and you're providing that have research, but you don't do the research. So, and it was a very interesting thing that you have to convince them that that's good. And now you give them this tool. Now, what do you add any other framing on how that should be used, even if you don't do the research in itself? Because otherwise you're giving a tool, and will they use it as a tool to build something, or are you giving a knife to a monkey?
Yeah, it's a really good point. What we try to do is, because most of the teams we work with, they're new to user research. Maybe they've done some in-house testing before, but that's kind of the knowledge level that they have. So there are really two ways that we approach this. One is that we make it really hard to shoot yourself on the foot when you're using our software. So you might have a certain, you have a tutorial problem. So there's like one approach that is suggested on our website that, like, you just drop in your questions pretty much and then it does the right thing, ideally. We do that with a couple of things, a couple of like different study types to constrain it a little bit and thereby make it harder to fail in doing your research. And then also, I mean, sometimes we just need people like Jason to come in to teach the teams and help them actually use these tools better, because there's only so much you can do. But generally, they're quite, like, it's an iterative process. The same way you want to iterate on your game, you got to iterate on your methods.
Let's take a moment to introduce our next roundtablist. I just want to make sure we all get introduced and get to dive in, and then we'll continue on with some of the conversations. So Audrey Laurent-André, is that correct? She's the user research project manager for Honor at Ubisoft Montreal. Fully embedded in production, she provided a realistic and actionable UR strategy for the project. Now that the game is launched, she helps adapt the UR processes in a live environment. Prior to that, she worked as an analyst on a wide variety of games at Ubisoft HQ. Audrey holds a bachelor's degree in computer science and a master's degree in game design. And the question that I have for Audrey is, some people are great user researchers and some people are great team managers. Few are great at both, although I have met some who are great at both, just if any of my former bosses are around. from a project manager's perspective, what processes have worked best or failed to work to get the best research driven into the game? Sorry.
Thanks. So one of the things to keep in mind is that we have processes at the lab to help everyone work together, because the lab is fairly a huge number of people, ranging from data analysts to user test analysts. So, but the production has also their own processes to ensure that things get done. And basically, you arrive in the middle of that and say, okay, now we are working together, but you can't just come with a hammer and break everything. So you have to ensure that everything is going to work together. And at the beginning, when I started, we had these own processes in Jira, and people were like, yeah, put your findings on Jira, and I ensure everything's going to be acted on. And that didn't work. At all. And I tried just chasing individual people saying, hey, you have this to do. And basically it didn't work because it wasn't the way they were using the tool and they were using our findings. So in the end, we choose another approach, which was to have regular meetings with the direction to say, okay, we have those issues, they are entering the tool, what do we want to do with it? And who should take care of that? Who is the owner? Is the next step having a discussion between user research, designers, directors, programmers? What's the next step? Who should take care of that? And how important is it for all of us? And the interesting thing is that the user research findings were also with the like director's wish list, which means that we were able to prioritize things like in general, and user research findings weren't just on their side, not prioritized with like the whole picture of the project. And like that's basically how it ended up working. And it was really a conjoint effort with the production director, with the game director. Like we just all sat and say, that didn't work. What's our next step that could work for everyone, basically?
So what I'm hearing there is that it's ownership of driving it into the game is like this key part of the chain that can't be missed. It can't just be handing something over the wall. And where you were most successful is when you're able to drive that process and have the buy-in from the stakeholders at those meetings and make decisions and move forward. Okay, next for Tom Blind. After years of working on small independent games, Tom co-founded Backflip Studios in 2009. He led the studio's design teams on all products, including Dragonvale, Ninjump, and Army of Darkness Defense. He worked to create many of the processes needed to develop fun, quality products, including dedicated UX and research practices. In 2017, Tom ventured onward to work on independent games once again. So for Tom, the developer in the crew here, give us the developer's perspective. What do you need from a user researcher in the middle of a firefight? And what do you need to build and maintain a long-term relationship with your user researchers? And if I can, you might not talk about this, but Tom's had a chance to work with a number of Gersig alumni over the years as researchers that have helped out Backflip Studios. So he's had experience with a bunch of different UR folks over the years. Yeah, oh, yes.
Thanks, Jason. So I kind of come from the other side of the coin, right? Just working with user research experts, trying to implement those processes in our own games. What do developers need when they work with a user researcher? Well, they just need someone to come in and give them all the answers, right? You know, do some research and tell us how to fix our game. at least that's what, you know, they usually think they need, right? When everything's on fire, everybody just wants kind of quick, easy solutions so that we can get past it and ship a game. But it doesn't really work that way. And I've had to have the discussion with developers many times that, you know, bring somebody in who isn't as familiar with the product and isn't, you know, as close to it as we are, they're not going to have all the answers right off the bat. They need to work with us, and we need to work with them to come to those solutions and truly identify what those problems really are. So, you know, what do we actually need? We need somebody who understands the logistics of user research, right? Somebody who understands how to find participants, what types of participants to find, what kind of setup do we have, right? Do we use cameras or double-sided glass, or do we do like group sessions or do one-on-ones? You know, there's so many different ways that you can do these things. What's appropriate for the product that we're working on and the problems that we're seeing? Additionally, we also need somebody who can help us kind of back up for a minute, right? When everything's on fire, developers are going to be very, you know, very laser focused on what they think the problems are and kind of get tunnel vision at certain points. They may be missing, you know, the forest for the trees, so to speak. They may not see, you know, bigger problems that are at hand or maybe missing other things entirely. So they need somebody who can go, okay, I know you think these are the problems, but let's back up and say, what are the questions? What do we want to answer that's going to actually validate what we think the problems are or potentially expose other things that we may not be seeing? And finally, you kind of need somebody with experience, right? Somebody who's seen a lot of fires before, who can go, oh, I've seen this kind of situation, and last time it turned out to be this thing, or, you know, we tried this thing last time and that actually didn't work at all, so let's not do that, you know, or don't ask those kinds of questions because users will actually get a negative reaction and you'll get bad results from that kind of questioning. You know, things that the developers themselves, you know, haven't experienced and don't truly, you know, they won't know if those kinds of things are going to be problematic for them during the testing. So kind of long story short, you know, they just need somebody who can guide them through the process because they don't know that process themselves and they're busy trying to put out a fire. Learning a whole new process is going to be very intimidating for them at that point. In terms of building relationship, kind of the second part of the question there, it's trust, right? You want to build a relationship with somebody, you know, if you're working externally with them and build up a sense of trust with them. So with your team as well, so that when you're like, okay, everything's on fire, we're going to call Schklar and, you know, he's going to come in and help us out with this. And you ideally, you know, we've worked with him before, the team will go, all right, that's going to be the solution. We're comfortable with him. We know, you know, we believe he's going to be beneficial to us here. And so you can kind of get to fixing the fire quickly. But obviously you're not going to have that when you first start doing this. And so, you know, that's going to be something that takes potentially multiple products, and a bit of time to actually build that up. So, and that's kind of a whole separate topic in of itself.
And to be clear, it was, you know, call Schklar or call Kieker or call Drexel or call a number of, thank you for the. Yeah. Or find full-time jobs or. Oh, okay. For Veronica, Veronica's a Mido. She is the lead senior UX researcher at Electronic Arts. In her role, she is responsible for UX research activities across all EA products. Veronica manages best practices and standards for executing high quality research, efficiencies for methods, exploring new processes, and ensuring actionable findings. She has worked on multiple projects, including Battlefield, Plants vs. Zombies, Garden Warfare, Madden, FIFA, NBA Live, NHL, Star Wars, Battlefront, and among others. She completed her Master of Science at Simon Fraser University in the School of Interactive Arts and Technology. And for Veronica, my question is, we can't give 100% user research funding to every development team. How do you work effectively and preserve positive relationships with teams who want more research than can be budgeted? Let me pass this down to Veronica.
Thank you. It is a challenge. It's a constant challenge how to balance budget, time, resources, what you need to put there, and what you get done. And I think that it's an important mindset that we do research, but we are ultimately a business. And I think that it has to be with adapting the mindset that many of us coming from a strong academic background to we have to do research and, you know, really pushing through, and you did your research and they were like nights were like very short because you were all awake and caffeine. And sometimes I see a lot of people trying to carry that over, and I think that everyone is a really nice person and you're really trying to help the team. So I will urge you to not jump on that wagon of just trying to crash with resources, and how to balance that from a business perspective. And here is when you know, wearing your researcher hat, but without, you know, going crazy and it must be done, you have to prioritize. And for that, you have to do it with their team. You can indicate, you know, what should be the most important, what you know from your best practices of what are the key components that are going to shape the player experience and try to put those forward. But it's not your own decision, and you should not shovel that down their throats. It's a shared collaboratively process, and you need the game to be on board with that. And it's going to touch on morale of people. Someone's feature is not going to be important enough to not get research. Ouch. It hurts. So you have to be empathic with that. And that's why treating that problem as a group is key. So maybe if you have a mature team, you can have those champions or the leads of the project, and they can help to propagate that through the team. And if you don't have those champions, or it's not that clear, or the team is still struggling to that, I encourage people to do kind of like a breakup moment or a workshop-y component where you can like redefine where the game is and what's more important, and that everyone can actually be part of that process.
Yeah. I think I'm going to open up to questions because I thought we had till noon, but we had till 5 till. So if folks, I have some other questions here that I can list from a menu of items, but if folks are already sort of champing at the bit for a question, and I think we need to hand, yeah, here you go. We'll have time only for two or three, but we'll hang out a bit at the end for chat.
Hello. So I'm a student, a graduate student at the University of Utah, and my question's kind of like, so what do you do if you're the one that made the fire? Like, you did something wrong when you were researching? Like, it's good for me because I'm a student, because I can be like, oh, I'm learning. But in the industry, it's a little bit different. Like, how can you kind of like, either like put in blockade so that you have a check there or something where when the fire's going, you know what to do to contain it.
As you said, first of all, we try to ensure that that happened like the less often possible, but yes, it can happen. The fact is that on our side is that we are many to look at like research results. So we have like proofreading, which means that at some point someone will most of the time pick up that something goes wrong. And the thing that is interesting is that we also present the results to the team like directly. And so sometimes they pick up that something, it doesn't really make sense. Even if they just have like a small doubt, we're gonna double check, and sometimes they're right. But I think that what you are talking about is when like all the proofreading didn't work and that's something completely messed up. Well, at some point, what I've said, it happened to me once, and when I said to my team that it happens, sometimes you make bad design call based on false assumption, and I gave you not the right data and I messed up. And at some point, you just have to accept that because like accepting that is just like saving the trust that you have in between and just discussing what are the consequences so that you can assess where you are and how you can help them basically kill the fire. And just basically you have to take your responsibility with it, but like never hide it, like never. That's.
I'm just going to hazard a guess here, but I suspect almost all developers will have that happen at some point in their career. We all mess up sometimes, you know, and sometimes it sounded like the right idea. Like it makes total sense. Everybody's going to get that. And then, you know, you put it in some real user's hands and it just fails epically. And that's why you do these. You know, that's why you do user research. It's to identify those issues before you ship the product with those failures. So it's all just part of the process.
You can shout out a number as well if any of those sound interesting to you, so you don't have to ask a cool question yourself. Yep, Rick.
Because user research is much about partnering with research on the development team. I have question number two.
What are some examples of difficult developer relationships? How did you improve them, make them worse, or terminate them? Christian, you must have some juicy stories.
Yeah, which one? yeah, it can be really hard. I think the biggest topics that always come up is like timelines. Like, of course, everybody wants the results yesterday. That's not going to happen. And like examples. Okay, let's do examples. Very young research teams wanting a tiny sample size. Like, let's do this with two people. And they have to match. Like, I want one person who is like the perfect candidate of this persona we have, and the other person does this. And then you gotta tell them that this is not valid and this is really not what you should do. But at the end of the day, they're the ones paying the bill in our case, because we're just the service provider. And oftentimes they listen to us because we can tell them, hey, we've done this before, it's not gonna help you. Sometimes you just gotta do it. And then they fail usually, and you try to communicate with the team and not just the manager and tell them, hey, you might wanna like look at this. We have a blog post about this, maybe to make it a little more like, I'm not just telling you, this is a generic thing. So yeah,
In that circumstance, do they come back and blame you, even though you kind of tried to tell them ahead of time? Does that ever happen?
Yes. but it depends on who you talk with. Like, we try to split up a little bit, usually have more stakeholders than one. And to us, especially with very difficult relationships, it's sometimes important to separate the manager relationship and the game team relationship, because you can often salvage the game relationship. And with the manager, maybe you just need to send them some pretty slides or, yeah.
I have a follow-up on that, because I found that a lot of relationships are starting to get problematic when people don't check their egos. So we're going to walk into a meeting, make sure that everyone checks the ego outside, and we're going to do the best for the game and assume that everyone is coming with the best intentions. And I think that most of the examples I will go will be like people just cannot put their ego out, and that's problematic. So maybe helping to not make it, never take it personal, even if other people do it. I think that helps to maintain a healthy relationship. And try to always like refocus on what we're talking about, the game, or we're talking about the feature or the system, so that not everyone will be kind of like loading on that. And after that, go for coffee, chat, have a coffee, and work it out throughout. So yeah, it's funny. It's just like it goes back to the essence of human relationships.
That's all the time we have, actually. I'd really like to thank our roundtablists for volunteering their time and expertise to the group. We'll hang out here for a couple minutes if people wanted more one-on-one questions with any of the folks here. And I appreciate you all showing up and being here to participate.